Well, it started with a conversation I was having with my agent. He said, "What's your dream project?" And I said, "I want to find something about a kid discovering the Clash." So that's where the spark came from. He said, "It's out there. There's a project out there." He sent it to me. I met with the producers. They liked my take on it, and here we are. You know, 6 years later, at the London Film Festival for the premiere. It's pretty special. Yeah, you know, Jonathan read the script and really connected to it in a way that really was amazing to me. In terms of the first time we spoke, he had so many ideas, and he understood the pressure of playing such an iconic character from, you know, he's played Elvis, Henry VIII, and now Joe Strummer. So it really was a great meeting of the minds, a lot of fun to collaborate, and I couldn't have asked for a better experience with an actor. You know, Daniel's character's 14. It's a coming of age story, and the film is really about the power of music to change your life, and vis-a-vis the effect that discovering the Clash has on Shay, on Daniel's character.
In terms of the music of the Clash, why do you think it remains so iconic and so culturally relevant today?
You know, I think that they sang about universal things that are still relevant today, but the music itself just came from such a diverse, eclectic mix of influences from reggae to ska to some things that came out later kind of as punk. But I just think that the music is so original and so unique that it really stands up today.
What does it mean for you specifically to showcase the film here as part of the London Film Festival?
It's very special. You know, I always wanted to be able to come back and show the film to our London cast and crew, and to be at the London Film Festival is kind of the best way we could do that. So when we got the call, it was we were very excited, to say the least. So it's a wonderful night to be here. You know, I just hope that it inspires some conversation, whether it's about the music or about the social and racial and economic things going on in 79 that are kind of parallel to a lot of the things going on today in the States and here in the UK. Conversation starter. It's great if people want to talk about it. I would consider it a success if that happens.
How does it feel to be a part of this year's London Film Festival?
It's amazing. Like, I'm having the greatest time of my life, and I'm feeling a little bit nervous, but it's amazing chance here.
Can you tell us a little bit, for people who haven't seen the film, about your character and the journey that he's going on in this film?
So I play a boy called Shay Baker, and in the 70s era, it was really hard for him and his family to cope, and he wants to do the best for his family, and he falls in love very quickly with this girl, and he meets a member of the Clash, and he gets inspired by their music and everything about them. And it's just the overcome of their age. And then, that's it really. Well, I didn't actually know the Clash before I actually did the movie. And once I heard the music, I was just amazed. Like, if you listen to the lyrics closely, it talks about what happened in the 70s. And it's really inspiring to people that are growing up in today's world. Yeah. Well, Johnny was great to work with. Like, he gave me loads of advice. And it weren't even advice speaking to me. It was advice just being with him. And acting alongside him just made me feel more confident and just excited and happy, yeah. Well, I think audiences should take away from the film the fact that they're lucky to be around still, because back in the 70s it was really hard to live in. There was riots going on, there was racism. I think, yeah, just the fact that you're really lucky to be here still, yeah.
When I read the script, I was struck by the father-son relationship, you know, having such a, you know, an important relationship with my own father, and having two sons now, one who's 18 and one who's 22 months. And the music of the Clash was such an important part of musical history in this country and in the world, really. It had such energy and such anger and such hope and such optimism and questioning all the time about what our society was about and what it was doing for the young people at that time. And in Great Britain in 1978-79, you know, just 78 was the year before Thatcher came to power, and we're about to have all those years of destruction. And of, she was the most polarizing prime minister that I can think of, and certainly that was around when I've been you know, alive. And Thatcher was not a popular prime minister where I was brought up. And I was brought up in a very industrial area in Fife in Scotland. So the music of the Clash gave voice to the people who felt, you know, distanced and ignored and deliberately targeted by the Thatcher government. And so I think that the Clash and Joe Strummer, you know, were a sort of a beacon. They were a voice and, you know, that sort of light of optimism for a lot of people in the country. So I loved it. Well, I played Nick, who's Daniel's father, and we live, you know, he's a single dad and he lives in the suburbs of London, and he's estranged from his ex-wife, who went off to live in a sort of hippie commune in London. And he was in a rock band himself, but he gave up his dreams of being a rock star in order to get, you know, a job that could pay the rent to bring up his two kids. So he opens a music shop, he tunes pianos and he sells pianos and musical instruments, and he also, you know, drives a taxi. So he gets into a really bad accident and he can't work, so his son decides to pretend to be, you know, to be a woman and drive a taxi, and he meets Joe Strummer in London. And Joe Strummer and him sort of befriend each other, and it's really a story about a young kid coming of age, 14, about to be 15, discovering his, you know, his manhood really, and his, you know, really sort of reclaiming his identity about what it is to be a young man in London, and all that comes with. And when he hears the Clash, it kind of energizes him to sort of, you know, break free of the constraints that he felt were holding him back. So that's the story, really. I love Johnny. I've loved Johnny for years. I've known Johnny for a long, long time, and I think he's unique as an actor. I think he's got a very unique kind of energy about him, and he just really, he takes risks and he doesn't hold back. And, you know, everything from Elvis Presley to, you know, the Tudors, he's just such a, you love watching him on screen, and he's got a great, I'd say, very unique energy to him, and he's a very, very talented actor. Well, you know, I'm a big supporter of the film industry, and, you know, because I've done a lot of movies in my time, and the London Film Festival is a great film festival, and I'm glad that I'm part of it in some way. You know, I've had quite a few movies over the years at the London Film Festival, and it's a wonderful festival, and I think long may it continue, because, you know, the movie industry is slightly, not a bad thing, it's just the way it is. It's slightly been overshadowed by the rise of the new television industry, which, you know, was kind of started by Netflix and, you know, then Amazon and DirecTV have taken up the reins. So the television industry is incredibly strong and alive and kicking. So, you know, it's important that we have a film industry. I'm doing a series of Snatch at the moment, the TV version of the movie. So I'm doing that, filming in Manchester, set in London. I'm playing an East End gangster, sort of a godfather figure of the gang world, and I'm the great time.
How does the series compare to the film for people already fans of that?
It's different. I mean, it's a different take on it. It's just different characters and similar characters, but a different story and similar stories, and it's kind of inspired by, but different than the movie.
I am the bad mother who puts herself before her children and is deluded enough to pursue a career that she doesn't have a great deal of talent for, which is all terrific fun to play.
Aside from the specifics of your character, what was it about the project, this period overall, that most resonated with you when you read the script?
It resonated with me particularly. It was more, it was quite sort of nostalgic, I suppose, because my mum was a rock journalist back at that time, and she interviewed the Clash, and my brother was obsessed with the Clash, and his hero was Joe Strummer. So that was great to go back to that.
Why do you think, of all the great bands and musical icons of that period, the Clash and Joe in particular are ones that still feel so culturally relevant all these years later?
I think because they asked questions of the establishment. They were iconoclasts. They broke the rules, and they invented a different kind of music. You know, I mean, it's not to say that it didn't exist before. I'd say in our culture it hadn't really existed. before? Because obviously in other cultures, music and singing is, you know, was the first murmurings of rebellion or politicization or whatever. But I think, yeah, I was saying earlier on, I wish that punk was being invented now in the age of Trump. I think it would have been a great... we need some punk. Sadly, I didn't work with Johnny. I was only on it for 2 days. So I can speak about Daniel, who I think is going to be all over our screens in the coming years. I think he's terrific and he's lovely to work with. Really good. Really, really good.
How does it feel specifically to be part of the London Film Festival? What does this festival mean to you?
I love all film festivals, actually. They're one of my sort of, I think, music festivals and film festivals are my two favourite things, or favourite reasons to go out. So I love working in this country, and I wish I could always work in this country. So to me, doing a film here and being at London Film Festival, even though I was only on the film for 2 days, I still I'm going to shoehorn that into a bigger space than it probably should occupy.
Well, first of all, it was very comfortable because it's not a biography of Strummer, so that's easier. He comes into the story as a punk guru to the boy, like a punk fairy godfather. But the story is about the young man, Shay, played by Daniel Huddleston. He's also part of what attracted me to it because he's just so talented. And as an actor, you always look for other talented actors to work with because you learn from them. You'd be surprised how much you can learn from a 14-year-old actor. You know, things that you'd forgotten, just an authenticity, a natural joy maybe with what you're doing. There's a lot of joy with Daniel as a young man, so... So I was able to feed off that, and my Strummer became a little bit more humorous. I didn't try to play him as, you know, the iconic poet, because he hasn't become an icon yet. He's just a local working class hero right now, you know? Later on, in 1978, 79, 80, 81, when The Clash became huge, then you see Strummer more matured as the rock star. Right now, he's just the young guy wanting to fight and rail against the system as much as possible. We haven't changed, not one iota. The world is still as much of a mess, except now the percentages, the 0.1% of elite, have pulled even further away. The middle class that existed at the time of Joe Strummer and The Clash, it no longer exists. It's in a micro middle class, and then an enormous precariat underneath it. So this is what The Clash was speaking about. The reason it's so relevant is because nobody has changed. Yeah, you become trepidatious about it on occasion, you know who you're playing, but I'd already played Elvis, so, you know, I mean, it's like you can't get a bigger rock star than Elvis Presley. So, and the reason I was able to play Elvis effectively was because I never thought of him as Elvis. So I never thought as Joe Strummer as Joe Strummer. He's just Joe. It's that simple. And if I thought of him as Joe Strummer, this icon, then he becomes, then you place him on a pedestal. Instead of face-to-face, which is where he would have liked to have been with people. You know? That's how he got to learn. He was very, very funny. He was very, very humorous, very, very charming and warm. Now, the poetry may have been dark and anguished on occasion, but he himself had a great light about him. That's why people are attracted to him. But, you know, I was honored to be asked. So, you know, I looked at a lot of interviews, not on stage, some on stage of his work, but then once I'm on stage, I have to take it over myself anyway. So I was able to mimic sort of that sort of feeling. I was also playing and singing, which helped. So you're actually doing it yourself. But it's trying to capture them off stage as human beings with a little bit of humor, a little bit of wryness. Maybe there's an irony to it all. A naivety, and that naivety then later on got transformed into Strummer being a great poet and an icon. But you have to start with naivety. You have to start thinking you can change things. That's naive. And vulnerability works. And that's why himself and Shay are able to bounce off each other. They're feeding their own vulnerability. Stability breeds instability, so that's what he was doing. For films, certainly they have a smaller budget. This is a small film with a big heart rather than a big film with no heart. So when you're making small films and usually you have to have a good story, you have to have certainly a charming protagonist, and Daniel Huddleston is the most charming of young men. I don't know if you've ever met him, but he's a pleasure. And I think once you have those elements and you have a story and a time that's not common, people aren't really making movies about late 1970s, early 1980s very often. It's sort of like people think of it as a time of drudgery, you know, just coming out of a recession, Thatcherism, the Falklands War. These are things we don't really want to remember. But they're very, very relevant to how we're living today, because our eco-political systems were starting to get deregulated at this time. You can almost look at this period of time as the start of the 2008 crisis. Because it is. They started deregulating banks. They started privatizing banks. They started sort of taking the money from mortgage lenders and selling them on to insurance and investment company. You know, this is where CDOs were starting, you know? And I think what happened at this time, especially with punk, is that there was a lot of unrest amongst the youth. The Clash are different to the Sex Pistols, say. The Sex Pistols were very much about an energy, but the Clash were more talented as musicians, you know? So they could bring other mixtures. They could bring dub, ska, reggae. It very much became a sound of London. When you hear Bank Robber, you think of London. You think of nowhere else in the world. There's no other city in the world that that belongs to. You know, this is a Tommy Gun. There's no city in the world that that belongs to beyond being an English song about England. So, you know, he was an important voice at a time when the voices were getting drowned out. And today, we just don't have our Clash. They're not here at the moment, you know what I mean? But there's a great band in New York called Unlocking the Truth. They're three African-American kids from Brooklyn, and they play the best heavy speed metal you've ever heard, and they're in eighth grade. Since the trailer came out, the Clash's music has been going up and up on iTunes because people are rediscovering. Because you can't hide brilliant. No matter how many years pass, brilliant is brilliant. So I hope they have a huge second wind with their music, because it's so important. It really is so important. And Joe Strummer is way more important than people give credit for, you know?